thank you very much for being here. And I've been asked to say just a little about how I got into this, which is an unusual book for a theologian. I got into it because people asked me to do it. And I resisted it because, of course, it's an exercise in narcissism. But it turns out I'm just narcissistic enough to do it. I did it. And once I thought I saw how to do it, it became an absolute obsession. And if people say, how long did it take you to write it? I think I wrote it in about 7 or 8 months because I just found it flowed from me. Part of the flowing from me is that the book, I hope, is a literary book. That is, I want it to be a page turner, and I want you to be absolutely compelled by the story I'm telling. And that meant that it had to be done with art. I mean, my life has been constituted, as the story I try to tell, by friendships. And I can't dwell long on any peculiar friend, but I must try to draw them as quickly as I can, where you get a very distinct impression of who they are. Thus, when I talk about John Score, the man who taught me philosophy at Southwestern University, an unconventional man who lived conventionally, I hope that that gives you some sense of what an extraordinary figure he was for me. Or when Stuart Henry, friend at Duke, who was a Presbyterian, for who the world was very dark, but was condemned to live with Methodists most of his life, for who there was no darkness at all. I mean, I mean those kinds of phrases had to be produced, and they more or less flowed out of me, as I say. Of course, part of the story and part of the literary art of the book is that there are several stories in it, obviously. One, the son of a bricklayer who was trained to be a bricklayer, quote, makes good. Now, it's not clear, of course, by becoming a theologian that you've made good. You've clearly entered into a more dishonest line of work than laying brick. But that's a cliche, namely, working class kid makes good. So how do you write, but it's my story, but how do you defeat the cliche? The way you defeat the cliche, which I hope I did, is through detail. And how, what it means to write lovingly about what it means to be trained to be a bricklayer, and what it means to be let go by your family in a way that you will enter forms of life that your family will never be able to understand. When my father, the claim that as part a place in the book where I talk about the movie Breaking Away, where a young man and his father are walking across the University of Indiana, and his father is a cutter, and the young man is a student at the University of Indiana, and his son says, "I have class in that building," and his father says, "I cut the stone for that building. I've always wondered what it looks like on the inside." And his son says, "You never have been on the inside?" And his father says, "Oh no, it wouldn't be right." Well, my life has been spent in buildings that my father would never enter. You've got to feel at once the pain and the goodness of that. And that partly, having such wonderful parents, I call my mother in the book, and I've been criticized for this, a mammoth pain in the ass. She was, I mean, if you ever want to see hidden injuries of class, my mother comes from Hardscrabble, Mississippi, and she always was thinking, she was intimidated by the world, and therefore her way of not being intimidated was to try to do something for you where you would owe her. That's a pain in the ass. But you have to display that lovingly, and that's what I tried to do. The other story in the book that is very that's central, but I didn't want to make it central, was being married 24 years to someone suffering from bipolar illness, and how to write about that in a way that did not in any way demean Anne was something that I worked very hard at doing. You'll have to tell me whether I was successful or not. One of the other challenges in writing the book was once Anne and I were separated, and I was trying to convince my now wife of 21 years to marry me, which was very hard because Paula saw no reason why a marriage would necessarily be part of her calling. She's a Methodist minister. But once she finally agreed to marry me, the dramatic tension went out of the book. So how do you make sense of the rest of your life? Oh, I just became an academic. That's not interesting. And so, and one of the things I was trying to do was avoid in the book any sense that that this is the story of I did this then, and then I did that then. And so I didn't want it to be a chronological account of my, quote, successes. I'll leave that to Jürgen Moltmann. So I tried to avoid that. One of the things that, of course, the subtitle was originally a theological memoir because I wanted to integrate how I've learned to think theologically with the story of my life. I constantly look for new genres to write in a manner that theology just doesn't become one more position. And the press decided, not SCM, but the American press, thought that the phrase a theological memoir would hurt sales. And so they didn't want to use that. So my wife said, well, why don't you call it a theologian's memoir? But it's really meant to be also a work in theology and to exhibit what my how I've learned to think as a theologian. And so I tried to write in a manner of, I didn't want in any way for the theological parts of the book, the whole book is theological. I mean, if you can't read, for example, the sermon that I preached at my father's funeral without seeing that that's part of the most important theological display that that the book is about. But it's a sermon at a funeral. I wanted to integrate the theological reflections in a way that didn't sound like, and now let me do a little theology. I wanted it to be integral to the story I was telling. And you'll have to tell me how successful I was in that. People ask me what I learned from doing it, and I don't know that there's any one particular thing that I learned. I mean, the book ends with, I'm a Christian, how interesting. And that is a discovery that I'm constantly surprised at, that I'm a Christian. How interesting, and my friends make me a Christian. I mean, part of what I was trying to do in the book was, I mean, I hate pietism, and I hate language of interiority. So I was trying to tell the story in a non-subjective manner, which is not easy. And that had to do primarily with the display of friends and how they have kept me, made me more than I ever thought I could be. I want to end by calling attention to John's blurb, which I deeply appreciate. John wrote, where did you write it, John? In the back, right. Yes. Stanley Hauerwas, the most important living influence in Anglo-Saxon theology, which is bullshit, has given us the story of his journey from blue-collar origins to the heights of academia in tones that are remarkably at once candid and restrained. The tale has the ring of entire authenticity, and it had to be written because Hauerwas' work of writing and his work upon himself are so clearly, as Michel de Montaigne, one and the same. But in either case, as this book reveals, the work is really an attention and a receiving. The title will remind other British readers of the very Victorian and yet compelling Ladybird book, Picture of the Child Samuel, Summoned by Jehovah in the Darkness. Stanley Hauerwas is just that kind of prophet. What I want to call attention to is John's, I think, extremely insightful claim. It had to be written because the work of writing and his work upon himself are so clearly the same. I've become a Christian because I forced myself to write as one. And by forcing myself to write as one, I've learned how to deny the self. Because writing is an ascetical discipline through which we learn to die. And so that is what I hope, part of what I've learned through the doing of the book. Thank you.
I'd like to just kind of open on this theme of the relationship between autobiography and theology. And one of the striking things, reflecting on both your background, John, and yours, Stanley, is you're both former Methodists now, married to priests, and working as lay, non-ordained theologians, and now members of the Anglican Church. And I just wondered how that inflects upon your own writing and your own work, and some of the connections, interesting personal connections there in terms of your own particular situations?
Well, I'm not a natural Christian. God just doesn't come easily for me. I'm naturally good. My wife is naturally Christian. I don't think it's good to be naturally anything because it has to be made into habit. But I have learned through my wife's ministry to stand in awe of people for who God is just there. And what that has to do, Paula is an ordained Methodist minister whose bishop has appointed her to the Church of the Holy Family in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, where we're communicants. I say, is there any relationship between Paula and I returning to the Episcopal Church and the church falling apart? No idea. But we're very happy to be there. And of course, we're there as Methodists. Methodism was a movement in the Church of England for the reform of the Church of England. In America, it became a denomination by accident. Therefore, it is a church that, by its very nature, must remain unintelligible to itself, which hopefully is a gesture toward Christian unity. And so that's what I understand my involvement. I say when I first became a communicant at the Church of the Holy Family, I worried about whether Holy Family was an Episcopal church, since Holy Family is usually a Catholic name. But as soon as they called the basement the Undercroft, I knew they were Episcopalians. Let no pretension go unused. So I've been made part of a different class of people who I struggle to relate to.
John, we're very familiar with the kind of Stanley's own journey from a Methodist and beyond, as it were. But you've never really talked about that in relation to your own work, and yet you've reprimanded me when I've accused of various things about saying,
I can't claim to working class origins like Stanley. My parents were, already quite academic, and I'm probably on my way to being a bricklayer. I think this the fact of sort of both having been brought up Methodist is curiously interesting, and there are other examples of this. And the reason why I think it's interesting is that really Methodism is very, very non-intellectual. I realized at the age of about 8 that I was a really peculiar Methodist because I liked ideas. That on the whole, Methodists are very, very pragmatic. And there isn't really a big Methodist theological tradition. I mean, there's some work on the New Testament and so on, since Wesley himself, and why suddenly are the kind of ex-Methodists, Methodists, members of other holiness churches, looking back towards Wesley, suddenly articulating theology? And I think there's an element of the Isle of Minerva about it, that sort of as if Methodism has served its purpose and is sort of going back to its origins in some kind of way. But also I think it's to do with that sort of pietist strand in Protestantism that was always sort of half recovering Catholic emphases, not having such a strong duality of grace and works. And it's got something to do with the sort of growth of post-Protestantism and Protestants sort of looking back to the whole of Christian history and being bound by the Bible rather than by the sort of the reformers, the magisterial serial Reformation. And it's something to do with sort of a Methodist sense of practice that it should really be, you should be living a holy life in whatever vocation you're in the world, sort of rejoining the sort of long-term Catholic roots and, ideas about deification and so on. And that, hence, I think, in my case, it was sort of a very natural journey from Methodist back to high church roots, indeed, to Anglo-Catholicism, really. I think just to say briefly, my vocation has very much been as a lay theologian, and so I've seen my task has been relating theology to other modes of human knowledge. Its place in the economy of knowledge has been my prime concern. But I think the fact that Alison has got ordained, and I've followed her around a lot and I know exactly what she does, has added a very sort of big dimension of relating my theology at one remove to what's gone on in the parish. And Alison's absolutely brilliant book, which is going to sound the death now for fresh expressions, is coming out next Monday and is called For the Parish. She co-wrote it with Andrew Davis. It's a totally brilliant book. big parish, big society is going to be, I think, the shape of the British future.
But better or worse.
Yes, nothing to do with David Cameron, really. Yeah, but those things are the real future. I've been able to think more about what my theology would mean. And I think what I now realise it means is that mission and the formation of society are absolutely one of the same thing. There's a brilliant book by a Yale historian that shows that British church attendance has declined because of the exiting from the sphere of culture, society, welfare, education, and so on. And I think what's going to happen now is that civil society and the church will expand in tandem again in Britain.
We'll come back to that, it seems. I mean, I just think, picking up on something you both said, and drawing on what you were saying, John, about the being, in a sense, both of you have very strong emphasis on A, the Catholicity of the Church, and in a sense have been in very intense dialogue, both institutionally, John, you with the Roman Catholic Church, with the Vatican and in other contexts, and also, Stanley, you at Notre Dame and throughout your life with Catholic thought. But you, in a sense, have remained Protestant theologians. And I just wondered...
I'm not
not a Protestant theologian, but in effect, you're not a Roman Catholic theologian.
No.
And I just wanted to invite you to reflect between you on what it means to not be Roman Catholic, and what does it mean, in a sense, to be... What is then the place of Protestant theology in the contemporary context? I mean, we could answer that question quite clearly, let's say, 100, 200 years ago. It's not so clear now. And it's interesting, you both stand, in a sense, at a liminal place between Roman Catholic theology and what is the future shape of Protestant theology. And I'll just invite you to reflect on that.
Protestantism is a reform movement within the Church Catholic to make the Church Catholic Catholic. Just to the extent that Protestantism becomes an end in itself, it denies its very being. That is, in America, where Protestantism became denominations, which and therefore became self-consuming artifacts, to use Stanley Fish's phrase, I think they lost our relationship with the question of the unity of the church. And so, I mean, one of the things about being Methodist was exactly, I mean, Wesley was, I've come from part of a resourcement movement within Methodism associated with the names of Albert Outler and Robert Cushman, who recovered the revival paradigm of what made Wesley Wesley. They denied by showing, as a matter of fact, that Wesley's deepest theological convictions grew out, as John suggested, of reading the Cappadocians in a way that holiness was part and parcel, a community formation. And that in a way that made, though there are streams within Anglicanism, not necessarily at the time of Wesley, that made Methodism, interestingly enough, more Catholic than the Church of England. And at least in terms of how it was being recovered. And then, of course, what I'm saying about what I take to be the Protestant charism about toward Roman Catholicism, and I prefer not to use the word Roman, but toward Catholicism is exactly will be a surprise to many Roman Catholics who have become, particularly in America, Protestants. So I take it that part of our job as who knows what church we serve, and that's part of the problem of who knows what church we serve. I don't know, I'm an ecclesial whore. I have no idea why God made some of us ecclesially homeless in this time if it's not the hunger and thirst for Christian unity. So I write theology in the hopes that what I'm saying will be received by a coming great church that is not immediately before me. Now, that you've got to worry about that, because that can lead you in some very destructive directions, because the church has got to be the church on the corner in the parish. I mean, one of the things, as John was suggesting, that being married to priests does is remind you this is about saying Mass every week, and this is about the formation of a people in that way. So I wouldn't know how to be a Roman Catholic. All I know how to do is to be in service to the Christian people that claim me.
Yeah, I'm an Anglican and not a Roman Catholic only because I live in England. And what I mean by that is that I don't have a quarrel with the Roman Catholic Church. I mean, I think we need some kind of ecumenical settlement that involves Pope in council in a much clearer kind of way. And I think the Orthodox and the Catholics are moving towards that. But for me to become a Catholic in England would somehow be too individualist a decision. That somehow for me, the parish system in England, the sheer concreteness of it, the physicality, the very geography of it, is part of what it means to be Catholic. It seems to me that the parish churches are the inclusive churches in England. As far as I'm concerned, this is the ancient Catholic Church. And as for the Protestantism, it's just here, it's a matter of a quarrel between the monarchy and the Pope. And a few days ago, the monarch and the Pope, seriously, and if you didn't see this, you didn't understand the meaning of the visit, they began to make up that quarrel. And this is a geopolitical event of the utmost significance. So for me, you know, it's about that. It's not about the 39 articles. Unfortunately, unlike my wife, I don't have to sign up to these. But it's very important that the prayer book itself is a very Catholic document. Most of the really hardcore reformers who were Elizabeth's bishops did not want it. It got through by a miracle. The Reformation is based largely on a voluntarist theology. When Hooker reverted to intellectualism, he essentially took Anglicanism in a Catholic direction. Never mind the details. I also think that there is a certain real sense in which Stanley is right, that often Protestants have been much better Catholics than Catholics, because there's a lot wrong with Catholic theology quite often since the Counter-Reformation. Both Counter-Reformation and Reformation are rooted in rather bad late medieval theology very often. So, to my mind, the greatest Catholic British theologian of the 19th century is George MacDonald, who wasn't even an Anglican. He was a nonconformist pastor. MacDonald's grasp of patristic theology is better than anyone else's, including Newman. I also...
Woo!
Well, it's a lot better than Newman, actually. The curious thing as well about Anglican theology is that sometimes there's a sense in which it's ultra-Catholic. And what I mean by that is, if you look at Shakespeare, particularly Measure for Measure, if you look at Hooker, if you look at the poetry of Thomas Traherne, by criticizing Puritanism, they are discovering the absolute crucial importance of mediation. And that can mean mediation through culture, through the natural world. It can also mean mediation through sex, which is there in John Donne. So there's a sense in which, because Anglicans rejected Puritanism, they also saw the Puritanism even in too much the Catholic legacy, and started to develop an ultra-mediating theology. Thus, in Thomas Strahan, opening your heart towards God becomes also opening your heart towards the cosmos. Not a kind of pantheism, not like Walt Whitman, but not kind of leaving the cosmos behind. So it becomes much more genuinely apocalyptic. So for me, although I say, you know, I'm an Anglican because I'm in England, there is a real thing that comes through the Anglican theological legacy that is important.
But is there a danger? I mean, I hear what both of you are saying. Isn't there a danger, though, in the sense there's a move to abstraction? You're eliding the use of the term Catholic there as a synonym for the Christian tradition, as conceived as some mediation of notion, particular forms of theological reasoning and practice and all the rest of it, with a particular, what we might loosely call a denominational polity, and the differences that arise in the actual embodiment of that, and the debates that go on at the Reformation and then beyond are about that interplay of the Christian tradition and very concrete forms of particular practice in particular places. And I'm just picking up on both. I mean, Zanny, you were moving to some almost a kind of eschatological, there's a greater church out there, it's a kind of teleological church. And John, you were slightly eliding a historical account with a notion of the transmission of the Christian, the deposit of faith, as it were. And I'm not sure that's it's quite as straightforward as either of you, the account you're giving.
I think issues of historiography are really important, and to let the Church of England began with Henry VIII, I think, is a mistake. As Bruce Kay has argued, I think that you really have to see the Church of England as a regional form of Catholicism beginning with Bede.
Yes.
And that gives you a completely different account of why it is that you're Anglican in England.
This is totally true, because the Reformation just didn't succeed in wiping out everything that, say, Eamon Duffy talks about. And in fact, the observation of Christian festivals, saints' days and so on, really only came to an end at sort of something like the end of the 18th century. So that this sense of, you know, the absolute involvement of Christianity with every aspect of life, you know, it wasn't suddenly removed. You know, people often accuse myself and Radical Orthodoxy of sort of being vague about what churches we belong to, but the point is that, you know, the church is not primarily an institution. It's a body formed by the Eucharist and the celebration of the Eucharist. And the continuity through time and space is constituted by that. So when one's thinking about ecumenism, one's starting point should be, in some sense, disunity is an illusion. It's, you know, we are already united at the more fundamental level. That would be very much my starting point.
I mean, but both of your work, there's a very strong sense of place,
right?
And the negotiation of a common life in places and the formation of particular people in places.
I think if I could just add that, I think Anglicanism has a role in the conversation between the Orthodox and the Catholics, in the sense that I think the Catholics have a very powerful sense of the priority of the spiritual and the church criticizing the secular order. You know, the Orthodox are sometimes too sort of wedded to a sort of unity of the church and state. And it's possible that Anglicans are somewhere in the middle, that we do, through church establishment, we preserve, in a sense, Christendom in one country. In a certain way, while we still have this Latin sense that the church is itself the site of society and has a critical role in relation to the state, you know. But sometimes Catholics too easily accept the sheer secularity of politics.
I mean, if I can pick up on a point you made earlier, John, about the centrality of mediation to the transmission of faith. I mean, one of the things that's very apparent in the Eastern Orthodox tradition, you take someone like St. Simeon, the New Theologian, or others, and in emergent traditions like the Pentecostal tradition and in the Global South is, in a sense, this emphasis on the direct encounter with God, of the in a sense, the possibilities of an unmediated experience. And I'm just, in discussions about ecumenism, it's easy to talk about relationships between Anglicans and Catholics and others, and I just wondered what both of you would say to the Church of the Global South, and where the Pentecostal tradition is the primary form, and where, in many ways, an echo of that Eastern Orthodox tradition, there's a strong emphasis on the unmediated access, and how you would respond to that.
Easily, there is no unmediated access.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Not, and certainly not in authentic Eastern Orthodoxy. Yeah. Uh-huh. Once you've it's those Palamite illusions. It's not, the point is, yes, the hesychastic saint experiences God directly, the uncreated light, but always through the created light. You know, there isn't, and in fact, in the Eastern Orthodox tradition, more than the Western, even the beatific vision, the stress on mediation is stronger there. So, and I just had a Pentecostalist that was talking to me in London Citizens, and he said, John, the trouble with us is we don't have a sense of the person, only a sense of the individual. And, he's a committed, charismatic person, but he said, until we have a sense of the person and persons in relation, we're going to go on celebrating wealth, but it can be any amount, and it's supposed to be still God's work,
Well, I mean, what in terms of the ecumenical conversation, do you have any reflections more broadly? We're sitting here in the most religiously diverse, ethnically diverse city in the world now, and in a sense the changing place of the church in this place, and there's a requirement, and you mentioned London Citizens, there is a mode through which churches with mosques and others can begin to negotiate this common life and form a people who are holding up the importance of social relationships and personal relationships over against the depredations of the market and the state, as it were. But I just wondered if you have reflections in this kind of context on what ecumenical dialogue with the Church of the Global South looks like.
The way porcupines screw very carefully. I think that... in some ways it's like churches passing in the night, but that one of the things that we need to... in the Global South, if you think of South America and Africa, so such a different context, it seems that you just are... that growth is almost an end in itself. And that you don't... So Christians are not... are not bedeviled by the presumption, as Christians in England and America are bedeviled by, how can we make peace between diverse traditions? I refuse to ask that question. I want to ask, how can Christians be interesting enough that other people want to talk to us? That's how I try to reframe it, in a way to get away from the Christian sense that we need to be in control.
I think in the Global South, you've got a brutal market and often totally complicit states. So what we're seeing is that it's often only religion that can sort of reinvent fundamental human society. And don't get me wrong about the charismatics. In a way, they get something right, which sometimes... the Catholic Church neglected, in the sense that if you are poor, it really is important to... you need these strict moral codes to get you out of it at the immediate personal level. And we need to sort of join that up with the thinking about structural injustice and things. I think these are not either-ors, that we've got to bring them together. And I think more generally, we need a conversation between the intense practice of the Global South and the kind of intellectual Christian revival that I think we're seeing in Europe and North America. a strange revival that is really a kind of revival against the absolute failure of all secular ideologies. Therefore, even though religion is declining in Europe, intellectually and amongst young people, it's definitely reviving. But we need both the practical and the theoretical, I think. And I think in, you know, given global communications, that's going to be possible. It's already happening, actually.
I mean, as you look across, where do you think the kind of really important bits of conceptual labour need to be done theologically? What are the kind of pressing, the things that really need to be excavated and investigated in terms of theological work?
I suppose I would say the relationship between Christology and ecclesiology are absolutely crucial for how we understand what the theological future should look like.
I think we need a kind of a new sort of coming together of theology and philosophy, in the sense I think we need to sort of relate Christian doctrines once again to our account of fundamental reality. Because, and I think this is of relevance to ordinary laity, who often seem to live in a sort of bifurcated world where there are Christian proofs and then there's the sort of vaguely semi-Darwinian common sense that everybody now seems to inhabit. So thinking questions like, you know, what is life, what is mind, and how does that relate to Christian doctrine are, I think, now very, very important.
I mean, that brings me on to the topic of one of the interesting things about you. You've both been accused of being sectarian. I mentioned this to Stanley. He was rather surprised, John, that you'd been accused of this as well. I had to ensure that he hadn't.
No, he thinks I'm a sort of shockingly loose liberal. I think, yeah.
But one of the kind of paradoxes is you've both been engaged in very, very intensive, almost the more particular and distinctive and confessional the position you've outlined, the more it's led to very direct engagements with broader public intellectuals and intellectual debates. John, I think of your work with Slavoj Žižek, or Stanley, you're engaged with Ron Coles and others. And I just wanted to reflect on that seeming paradox. It's often very liberal Christians who have very little engagements beyond the realm of theology. And I'm interested to hear both of your reflections on that seeming paradox.
Well, you could say that our positions should not let us be as confrontational with other intellectual formations as we are. We're just confrontational because we're just confrontational sons of bitches. and therefore it's not the same as the position itself. But I should say, I don't think that there's any contradiction at all between a strong Christological center and the presumption that there is absolutely nothing we cannot comprehend and be in conversation with. I think the two are absolutely required of one another. And therefore, it was the presumption of liberal Protestant theology that the only way to be in conversation with alternative forms of thought was to play down your that God showed up in Mary's belly. But exactly that God showed up in Mary's belly makes it possible for us to have something to say that someone might want to hear.
Yeah, and I mean, I think Sam is right. We're both naturally combative, and without a tiny bit of an iota of grace, we'd be a nightmare. You know, but I think that is true. But I think more generally that yes, it's true that the secular world is never interested in liberal theology. Why would they be? You know, nihilism light. You know, why bother? Why go there? You know, a sort of gently baptized Hegel, Heidegger, Derrida, Marx, whatever. You know, of course, the secular world is never, ever interested in that, you know. And it's not an accident that today I was teaching a class of completely secular people, Rerum Novarum, and they said, my God, how did the Pope know all this in 1891? He was thinking entirely out of Catholicity, and yet he looks more relevant now than Karl Marx.
There are some deep similarities between Marx and Rerum.
Of course, there are many elements that are common to both. Of course, that's true. But the point is that the church, you know, theology is only ever taken notice of when it's true to itself, because then it has an alternative mode of analysis, you know.
And so what do you see then as the public role of the theology? Given that, what do you see as the public role of the theology?
I think increasingly that sort of basically humanism has collapsed, and we're now seeing a battle between various forms of naturalism and various forms of religious philosophy. And this is why the 20th century were basically philosophically was a waste of time. Because it was trying to explore an anti-metaphysical space that eventually got completely deconstructed and was actually the worst form of metaphysics because it was epistemology. And what you're now seeing is a massive return to metaphysics. Okay. And this is either kind of naturalistic or it's various forms of religious metaphysic. And there's a return really to a very, very serious argument, and suddenly all kinds of things are connecting. You know, we suddenly see there is a connection between a politics pushing civil society and the role of religion. That there is a connection between atheism and extreme market liberalism, or else extreme statism. And, you know, Vaclav Havel, whom I don't think is a religious believer, only the other day raised the issue that probably an atheist world is a very, very dangerous world.
I mean, I'm just wondering whether
it's a political issue now.
Stanley, that yeah. John could catch. I mean, that was. I think that's a good description what John has given of the European context. I wonder whether that's one. I mean, you've both worked in America and in Europe in different capacities. I'm just wondering if you would share that analysis, Stanley, of the American context, which has a different religious demography, but in some ways you've characterised as more atheistic or de facto atheistic than the European context. But I'd be interested if you'd comment on John's analysis there.
Well, first of all, I don't like the word public. I just want to know who's that's privileging. and so they do public theology at the University of Chicago, but I don't. I can't imagine theology that isn't done in a way that should be compelling to any human being. If it's not, then it's just blowing smoke. What I think, my way of going at this, I always say John does at such a high level what I have to do close to the ground. I just want to talk about something like, could we talk about avarice? I think the church has been, I think most forms of lust today are really forms of greed. You never get enough of it. And so I think that the church, if it could just begin to start asking, what would the church need to look like in order that we are able to see how the power of greed shapes our lives? Because, I mean, you know, I think we think we can, we think about lust because we think we can see when we get it wrong. But we don't talk about greed because we're not sure how you get it wrong. I mean, how do you know you're greedy? Two SUVs? I mean, so exactly by concentrating on very grounded issues like greed, is a way to start calling into question some very fundamental economic relations that now dominate our lives. So, I mean, the problem is we're now morally obligated to be greedy, and in order to make the economies go. And so that would be a place to start, because it's not like I've got some better alternative. What I want to do is produce better people.
When your response is there, interesting. And in earlier reflections, I think it characterizes both of your different methodologies. So I'm struck by the kind of use, John, you make of genealogy, as it were, and history, and the broader historical analysis. And Stanley, you, both in Hannah's Child and elsewhere, the place of personal history and autobiography and very close-up attention. Whereas that broad sweep, I mean, it's there in the analysis, but it's kind of tucked under the covers, as it were. That broad sweep historical analysis hasn't characterized your work, and that notion of kind of out-narrating a contemporary context, own self-understanding, and giving a different narration of that. And I just wondered, methodologically, it's come out in both of your responses. Where is the place of history in each of your theological methods, and how would you characterize the differences between your own particular approaches to theology? Sorry, I do apologize. I'll turn it over here.
Well, John wants to win. I want to survive. And that's a very different, I think, orientation. John's just smarter than I am, so he can engage in the... and, of course, I've been influenced by McIntyre and John in terms of the extraordinary historical sweep of things. But I try to avoid the language of declension. I try to avoid the language of declension.
Oh, right.
Exactly, because I think the church always finds itself in tension with the world. And so it's not like we ever got it right. So one of the things I'm more concerned about is what it means. I use broad historical analysis. Charles Taylor's A Secular Age is obviously some help in that kind of thing, to help me give a diagnosis of the world in which I now have to negotiate being a Christian. But I don't want to take it over. John wants to take it over.
Do you want to respond there, John?
Oh, no, I definitely want to win. No question. It's absolutely right. There's nothing wrong with winning. Just because Christianity is about, peace and charity and humility and so on, doesn't mean we don't want to win, because precisely we want those virtues to win, we want them to prevail and to transform the world. That's just the program of salvation, as far as I'm concerned. And I think the church has suffered for too long from a sort of a false consciousness that turns losing and the apparent inevitability of losing into a kind of kenotic following of Jesus. It's not. It's a lie.
I didn't say I wanted to lose. I wanted to survive.
No, I know you didn't. I'm just criticizing a whole load of other people, and I don't think this will be exposed, I feel, on the...
So your comments remind me of being English football supporter. Right, it's like one commits oneself to
yes, so I do
a
want,
love of failure.
I do want to win, and I probably won't survive. I think that really, if you think about McIntyre, we are sort of both concerned with genealogies, because McIntyre is massively concerned with genealogy, and I think even though our approaches are different, we both believe in, at once, in ontology and in narrative and events, and realize there is a tension between them. In other words, we're not process theologians. We think there is a metaphysical context, but we also know that you can't do the final metaphysics, and that events cause you to revise your metaphysics, if you like, that you have to do it again, that an event isn't just contained within a kind of ontological box. It can you know, disclose new things, if you like. And so in my thought, I try to sort of live out that tension. And you can either think of that in terms of the narrative of history or in terms of a personal narrative. This is why, you know, the story of your life and reflecting on your life is part of your theology. It was for Augustine, it was for Stanley. Although, I mean, I would like to explore the difference between Augustine's more, shall we say, in some ways more confessional tone and Stanley's very sort of exteriorist kind of narrative, which you talked about. You know, that I think has all sorts of interesting... I think if I wrote an autobiography, I'd probably be much more confessional, which is why I'm never going to write one. That's a promise. but, you know, I think that an adequate theology has to be on all those levels of, you know, personal history, the history of the church, the history of the whole world, the metaphysical, the cosmic context. No one man can do it, or one woman.
It is itself a Catholic task.
Yeah, it is. And one of the biggest...
I'm just aware of time.
If I could just say very, very, very quickly, up till the age of sort of late 30s, I was an incredibly individualist theologian. The big discovery in my life has been the importance of collaboration in theology and how that can really enrich the whole process. And I do think that increasingly the apparently abstract and the very concrete do come together. Yeah.
I'm just going to want to open it up. For one last question before we open it out to the floor, which is if you were going to characterise a congregation, a local place-based in communio congregation that was formed according to each of your respective theological visions. How would you characterise that congregation, and what would be the differences between them? How does this play out for the actual congregation?
I'll just give you an example. It's Mass at Trolley, France, with Jean Vanier's large community. That's the congregation that I'm sure we will see in heaven.
Well, you know, I sort of, what one knows is one's local thing, and so I suppose for me it would be, you know, a beautiful sung Anglican liturgy in a church that was also the focus of the community, where people met, where they put on events, where they did business, where they did drama, that we need to restore the sense that the church is where all kinds of things happen, and to mixing up the secular and the sacred again, as they did in the Middle Ages.
Let me open it out to the floor of questions. We've got a roving mic, I think. So I'll someone hand at the back straight away in the black. You sir, if you want to. Sir.